There we go. We are live with Matthew.
Hey everyone, Hello. How you doing? I think this is my first time on a live YouTube.
We were discussing that while we were waiting a little bit, we should not call you Professor, but the Professor.
What I've been sort of looking at from a term is what people have been calling me at work is the Breducator.
That's also a good one.
Yeah, it's kind yes. of become a nickname at the college as the Breducator.
Yeah, I'm super excited to have you on this show because you reached out to me and the story was actually the following. I was posting a picture of this, I think, on my Instagram account, and then suddenly I got this message from Matthew James Duffy, whom I never heard about. And then I checked out your profile and it said a baking professor and chef. And that's pretty much how I got you on the show. I was so excited. I thought a professor for sourdough, how can that be? And yeah, now we are talking.
Yeah, great. I mean, bread look great anyways. I always like to sort of poke around. Sometimes I play the, every now and then, you know, you see some information that's maybe not correct and I like to correct people. And then that said, I'm sure at some point I've also taken something in. You know, there's a lot of information about bread out there that you read online, that you see on YouTube, that you read in books, and it's all conflicting. You know, I have 10 books on my shelf over here. I have over 400 cookbooks in my house, and every single one has a different way to make sourdough. Recently, I actually commented on someone's post about, you know, you can actually make a sourdough starter without discard, because for years I taught this and I read this in all the books, is that you build a starter, you take some out, you throw the old away. But in the actual initial phases, it's totally unnecessary to throw flour away. And a baker in the UK said, look, if everyone in Canada made that style of recipe, you're throwing out 500,000 loaves of bread in a short period of time. And I kind of thought, okay. So then I worked on, but sometimes when you learn something, you just think that's the way. And one of the my favorite things about your channel is that you try a side by side, or like, hey, well, you know, why do we do an autolyse? Let's see is it really beneficial? Does it really matter to the home baker? Because I think there's certain circumstances where things work in a bakery but don't work at home, and also the opposite way.
Okay. And how comes that you became a professor for sourdough baking, or in general professor for bread? How did that happen?
So the way that the system, or the way that the title comes, is that they're based on industry experience, knowledge, education, and formal training. And so essentially when you're teaching, you're an instructor. So if you're just teaching a class on a contract, you're a baking instructor, or you're a baking chef instructor or culinary. But once you sort of take on a full-time position, at this level, they actually title it as professor. And so in some ways, I always feel a bit strange with the title, because I know there's people who are doctors and have put in, you know, a lot of years into their craft. But it's also in the same way, many chefs and bakers do the same thing in their craft. And I know, for example, in Germany, you know, to become a certified German master baker, you know, it's 3 to 5 years of work plus testing plus, you know, apprenticeship. And so it's mostly based on that. And to answer the question of how it came to be, I have a long history of cooking and baking. I worked in Michelin restaurants. I worked very high end in Japan, Italy, Spain, Denmark. I spent 5 years working for Chef Daniel Boulud, who's quite a famous French chef based in New York. And the whole time I was baking in some capacity, whether that was on the weekend for the farmer's market or in the restaurant, or going in on my day off to work with the baker, or actually running the bakery of the hotel that I worked at. I kind of did all of those. And so it's kind of funny, because a lot of it happened through social media. And I was asked, I asked a friend of mine at one point, hey, this is a while ago, hey, how do you have such a good Instagram account? And I think he probably had around 20,000 and I had around 2,000 or 3,000. And he said, well, let's look at your account. He said, people seem to like your bread, so why don't you post more bread? And so I started posting more bread. And at first it was, here's my loaf of bread, look at me, I'm so great. But then it turned into, here's a loaf of bread. And someone would ask a question, well, how did you get that result? And I slowly started answering. And then I turned it into, here's the process, here's the flour, here's the breakdown, here's the baker's percentage. And I continued to pursue that and continue to bake that, continue to work in bakeries. When I first started teaching, I had zero intention of actually doing it full time. I was in the plans of either opening a restaurant or a bakery myself. My wife, who's a cancer survivor and was pregnant with our first at the time and sort of through the process, we had our first child. I thought, you know what, it's going to be tough. We're going to have a kid. I'll do this teaching thing for 3 or 4 weeks and then I'll go back into restaurant. And for anyone that's watching that knows restaurants and bakeries, it's a very difficult life. It's very long hours. You know, after doing it for 15 years, it eventually sort of takes its toll on you. And so I started teaching and I just really enjoyed it. And what happened at the college was we have an incredible chef that set up our baking and pastry arts management program, but her background was pastry chef, chocolate, sugar, and less of bread. And while she had a good knowledge of bread, the focus of the program was more based on those other skills, chocolate, cakes. And so when I first started on a contract, I had voiced to the chair of the college and said, look, you know, I think this is a great program. Don't take me the wrong way, but here's some things I think are missing from the curriculum. I think that we should be working with freshly milled flour because I think this is a sort of upcoming trend or whatever that you're going to see more and more of. I think we should be working with naturally leavened breads, and I think we should be working with guest bakers. And so through those three thoughts, we went from doing sort of yeasted white breads with what I would consider to be commodity flour to now running a program where we only use organic flour. It's 100% Canadian, 100% organic. We mill almost all of the whole grains ourselves. So we have a large commercial 26-inch stone mill. So we do that. The students run the mill. They set it up for the next day's class. So they come in, they mill the flour with some supervision. The only time where we're not milling the flour, I guess, is when we receive some donations, which I'll talk about after. But I mean, for example, we've just received a donation for a project I've been working on. And so I'm using the flour from the company. We did the mill. We also installed a hearth oven. So I had noted that, hey, look, I think that if we had a hearth oven on the campus, we could teach students about, you know, how to sort of run these different bakery operations. And I don't want to necessarily use the term artisan bread, but let's just say that's, you know, the hearth bread, the bakery bread. And so we were looking at all of these elements to improve the program. And it really, I think, got noticed by the people at the college that I was just very passionate about bread and I was very invested in making this a better program. And very quickly, I got very fortunate. So I don't know how it works in Germany, but in Canada, it's very difficult to come by a full-time position teaching for chefs and bakers. And especially now, because of COVID, with so many people out of work, everybody wants to teach. And so I just happened to be in the right place. I showed very good changes to the program and I was adding something they lacked. And I mean, again, not to knock what they were doing, but we had a cafeteria that student run and we were buying bread, making sandwiches and putting that. And I was like, we have a whole studio here with a deck oven. Yeah. And like, why don't we make the bread? And we started off with doing pizzas, big slab sheet pan pizzas, real simple with fresh milled flour. And just really quickly, the energy went from, you know, you ask 100 students, what do you want to do when you graduate? And 99 said they wanted to decorate cakes. And now it's 50-50. Half our students want to go into bread. Some want to do fine dining, some cakes. And so it really is this sort of like sum of all things and me just adding that value to the program to our students. And when the full-time position came up, I wrote a very big proposal of what my views of the program should be, how we should expand the program, how we should expand it domestically and internationally. And I got hired full-time. And now it's been 2 years. I think 2 years, just over two and a half years, I guess, of being awesome. Full-time and absolutely changed my life. It's absolutely been the most amazing experience. I've grown as a chef, as a baker. I've had opportunities to learn. I've had opportunities to travel. We can talk about all of those different projects we've worked on at the college. And I think that to fully answer the question, it is a little bit strange sometimes when I think of it. And even a lot of times when people call me a baker, I will say, oh, well, I'm not a baker, I'm a chef. And it was actually a few weeks ago when one of my friends said, he said, you know what, you are a baker. Like, I mean, look around me, I've got 150 kilos of flour here. I've got a spiral mixer and I've actually got a dough auto-leasing in the mixer. I teach baking for a living. both at the college and through my own channels. And he was like, what are you talking about? You're running a micro bakery. You're like, you are a baker. But I think it's just, I don't know. It's just been one of those transitions of life that I guess that I haven't, my brain hasn't really caught up to how fast we've been moving.
That's amazing. And I think also Canada, at least in Germany, sometimes when you want to get a high protein flour, for instance, people like to buy Manitoba flour. And I think that's a province in Canada, isn't it?
Yeah, it is. So Manitoba is actually a province in Canada. The funny kind of ironic thing is it's not really where the wheat is grown. While there is some wheat there, the climate's a little bit closer to what Ontario is, where we are probably better off growing. There are some great Ontario farmers, so I don't want to say we don't or can't, but more what you see here is rye and not as hard or high protein wheat. So the ironically, most of the Manitoba flour comes from another province, but whatever.
Okay. And when students attend the college, do they also have to write some kind of bachelor's thesis in the end on bread baking, or what kind of certificate do they get in the end?
So our program, we have a baking pastry arts management, and we also have baking pastry arts skills. The skills is a one-year program being two semesters essentially, where they just get skills and they get a diploma. And through that diploma, they get a job in the industry. And then in our baking pastry arts management program, they do four semesters, including a 14-week work integrated learning. And so they do the same two semesters as the skills program. And then in the third semester, they have the specialty courses. So in the third semester, they would take a chocolate specialty course, my 14-week artisan bread program, a 7-week sugar and confection, and a 14-week cake decoration. And through the program, we have both skills and operations course. And so skills would essentially be two students, or one student works on a recipe making two. Let's say they're making macaroons. The students would make like one tray of macaroons. And then we have a production course where the students are actually making hundreds. So they get both experiences. Once they get into their work integrated learning, we've developed it to be fully online with research-driven, community-driven projects, but the students can also go work in a local bakery or restaurant, which is sort of the traditional method. And then upon graduation, they would graduate with a diploma certificate, and they would be eligible to write their Red Seal, which is the certification in Canada to get your whatever, your Red Seal apprenticeship. If you're doing an apprenticeship, you have a Red Seal. Okay. That said, many of the students, because you're required so many hours, you're prepared to write the Red Seal, but unless you're really working a lot, you probably don't have the required hours. So our students will graduate, work in industry, then go sort of write the Red Seal. And a lot of people don't, a lot of chefs in Toronto just don't do it because it's, I don't know, a lot of people just don't do it because you don't really need it. Like no one, you can still open a restaurant if you want, you can still open a bakery without it. It's just a little bit of extra credential. And so it's kind of mixed what people, how people view it in this country. In my opinion, it's important. And I think everyone should, you know, do it, but I'm also an education person. So.
Yeah. And how much of your time would you say you allocate to teaching, baking, and then maybe even doing a little bit of research?
Great question. So, currently what we're doing is we're actually the only college in Ontario, which is the province I'm in, that developed a fully online digital program. So our students can be from anywhere in the world. And one of the great parts about that is that there's no requirement from the professor for in person. So everything's done online. I go in, I mark everything. But what I do, because I think it's better for the students, is I record videos and I say, hey, everyone, this week, here's what we're working on. Or maybe I'll record a quick video at home saying, hey, I've got this buckwheat flour. I'm going to talk to you about it. Here's what it is. Here's what we're working on. And I show the student an ingredient, a product. And then the other side of that is I worked on a project with a local mill, a Canadian mill, and they donated 600 kilos or about 550 kilos of flour. So every Thursday I live stream for about 5 hours and I bake between 50 and 150 loaves of bread for a local charity. And all the bread goes to Indigenous families across the GTA that are really in need. But the beauty of it is there's no requirement to do that. But I think that if you're taking a course and you can physically see the instructor doing the tips and tricks, you're going to learn more from it. So it's optional to the student if you want to come in. So With that said, I put a lot of effort into engaging with the students and really creating an engaging environment. We run discussion boards. We share pictures of our bakes. I have a team of four students that are currently working with me on a research project. So we're building out several booklets, several research projects. And then outside of that, I do a lot of baking at home. We did 30 pizzas last night for our local sort of group that we do our micro bakery. We did, I don't know, how many bagels do we make? Maybe 150 bagels or so. I've got some sourdoughs in the mixer. And so I don't really know how to answer that question because I'm just always doing it. I'm always working on something. I'm always either working on something at the college. I'm working on a development project. I'm working on my own personal website. I'm working on my own personal baking. And I, in some ways, because of working from home, it's really hard to separate. Because I want to make bread, but at the same time, I'm working because I'm going to show my students the pictures. And also, I'm probably going to make an Instagram video and maybe a TikTok. So I don't know. Awesome. Like what I try to do is, as far as the research goes, is I set aside the time weekly to really push the project forward so that I do have allocated time for I'm going to only work on the computer on Tuesday. There's going to be no procrastinating baking, and I'm going to further this project that we've been working on.
And just to show everybody how much of an amazing baker you are, I found this one video which I wanted to show everybody. And my question then afterwards would be to you, what is the perfect sourdough bread for you? I'm going to be showing the video now. Enjoy the footage. Isn't that the perfect sourdough?
Beautiful. Well, so that's a very difficult question. So if you were to think of what the perfect sourdough is, if I was to answer it in my personal, what the perfect sourdough to me is, somebody actually, I was on a live stream the other day on TikTok talking about breads, and I said something about, hey, I'm mixing a 90% hydration dough. And so somebody commented, well, I think that hydration is bakers showing off. Oh, I made 95 and it doesn't really matter. And then they said, I make a 50% hydration bread and it's quite good. And I personally thought, first of all, I would not want to eat a 50% hydration bread because I don't think it would be very tasty. However, they were baking, they were happy with it. So to them, it's perfect. And I think that for me, I really like the flavor to come through on the bread. I think that there's a deception with the way breads are perceived, and bakers chase the open crumb or they chase that perfect loaf. And I think that the first most important thing is the flavor. And it's actually a German baker, a very good friend of mine and mentor to me, Michael Schultz. He's a baker in Freiburg. Whenever I send him a picture of a bread I'm proud of, he always asks me, what's the taste? He never says, what's the percentages? How did you make the bread? It could be the most open crumb in the world. And he says, how is the taste? And he always emphasizes, this is more important to anybody. If you're baking bread because you saw it on Instagram, but it doesn't have a great flavor for what you like, then everything else is off. And so for me, the perfect loaf has a very grain forward flavor. When you work with quality flour, when you work with fresh grains, I think you should smell almost the bread in the product. So in my mixer here, there's a 100% whole wheat sourdough auto-leasing, and it smells very bready. It smells very wheaty, and I think that flavor comes through in the end. I like to use, so I have a chef training. I like to use probably a little bit more salt than what most traditional recipes call for. I'm between 2 and 2.5, whereas I think most traditional are 1.8 to 2% salt. If you look in sort of classic, like, Jeffrey Hamelman style sourdoughs, they're always 1.5 to 1.8. And then the other side of it is people often ask me, how do you get more sourness into the bread? How do you make it more sour?
That's an interesting question.
I think for me, the way that the sour should be used in the bread is the same way that it's used in cooking. So with the health benefits aside, that's another conversation. If we're just talking about flavor in a perfect loaf, when you're doing any kind of cooking and you see a pinch of lemon or a dash of lime or some sherry vinegar or even braising, You know, maybe you're making like a beef stew and it's got red wine in it. All of those things are acidity that help bring out the other flavors. So in my opinion, the acid behind the loaf should really help elevate the rest of the bread. So if we're making 100% whole wheat sourdough, it shouldn't be overly bitter, which often 100% whole wheat sourdough can be. It shouldn't be overly sour, which again, often can be. It should be sourness that brings out the flavor of the grain and salt that brings the flavor of the grain. And so for me, the perfect loaf has a thin but crisp crust, has a nice light texture inside, and overall has a flavor that I'm happy with. And to echo the comment about the hydration is a baker's show off, for me personally, I think that higher hydration breads actually taste better and have a better texture. And so that's the argument that I would have is that, you know, I mean, not to sound like, not to be rude, but I find often bakers that say, oh, well, I don't like open crumb because of whatever reason. I think honestly, a lot of them say it because they can't do it. And not to be too overly blunt, but I've heard a lot of people say, well, like, I don't like open crumb because I can make a sandwich on that. But I think it's really because they just can't do it. And then they make up their mind of like, I don't like this. But if you really have a true, properly, naturally leavened bread, it doesn't have to be wildly open like the video you just shown. That nice balance of fermentation. Through managing the fermentation, you're going to get optimal acidity. Through managing the fermentation, you're going to get optimal crust and crumb. You're also going to get optimum texture, and all of those things contribute to flavor. So I don't know if that's really, I'm taking a long time to answer a simple question, but I think the perfect loaf of bread is very subjective, and it can depend. I mean, I go through phases, I'm sure you do too, where I made this recipe for 100% whole wheat bread for a year before I was really happy, before I actually would write the recipe on my website. I did it for a year of trial and error. And I mean, I have one over here I can show if you want that I overproofed. I made them the other day and I overproofed it. It's a little flat and it still tastes good. Is it perfect? Definitely not.
Yeah. Yeah. It's always this, for at least for me, when I'm baking, I'm always trying to change one variable, change one parameter. I'm never 100% satisfied with what I'm baking. There's always room to improve, I think.
Yeah, I think you're right. I think that the best thing to do in that regards is to keep notes and make small changes as you go. I mean, I made this bread at 95% hydration, and today I've scaled it back a bit because I've overproofed it. And I think that the extra hydration has sped up my fermentation a little bit, and so my timing was a little bit off. But just by making those adaptations is really what makes you a good baker. I mean, that's why you have a great YouTube channel, you have a great product, you're making great breads. It's because you care to make the product better. You're interested in getting better. And if you're getting 1% better every bake, even if you make that mistake, even when you have the fail, you should still be getting better from it because you know what you did. I think those things all will contribute to making that,
And when you're saying you have a dough proofing, do you use some tools, let's say a proofing box, something to set the temperature, or do you just let everything ferment and proof at room temperature? How do you do that?
Great question. So I bought a Broad and Taylor proofer in November because I had been baking panettone at the college naturally leavened every year over Christmas. And because the college was closed, I wanted to bake panettone at home. And I think it's very difficult for anyone that's interested in if you truly want, I think it's some bakers call it the Mount Everest of baking. I think it's definitely one of the most, for me, in my opinion anyways, you know, the two hardest things to do are a hand laminated croissant in a home kitchen and panettone in a home kitchen and panettone in a commercial kitchen. Like panettone is really hard. There's a lot, it's really hard. And so I actually bought the proofer with the sole purpose of making panettone. And that was the only reason I bought it is I want to nail this recipe. I'm going to make it every single day until I'm happy with it. Before that, I just used my counter. I prefer to do an overnight fermentation in the fridge. So I think that the loaves get a better shelf life. They get a better, it's easier to handle. And I also think they're better flavor. Plus for me, I mean, I'm baking upwards of anywhere from 2 to 20 loaves of bread out of my home kitchen in Challenger bread pans. And so I can only bake two at a time. So if all of my bread's proofed on the counter and ready for the oven, I can't, you know, it might be an hour. And I've got a 2.5-year-old, right? She's like, my daughter's almost 3. Like sometimes I need to put it on hold for an hour and then come back to the bread. So I do most of my final proofing in the fridge. Anything that's room temperature, you know, bagels the other day or the pizza dough. I just do it at room temp. I'm in Canada, so it's really cold outside. I've got a front room that's very cold, so I'll put the dough in the front room. Yesterday when things were moving too fast, so we have two doors and the front room's like a mud room, I actually opened the front door to my house to cool down the front room so the dough would cool down.
Yeah.
I'm sure you've done similar where I've got a basement that's at about 17.8 degrees in a certain corner, so I'll keep those in that corner. I've got a cooling rack at the back door, which is a bit colder, and I just really play the game of, I've got a hygrometer. I can see one from where I'm sitting, and there's two in my basement, and so I've got them kind of all over, and I just adapt with it. And the as far as the actual proofing bread goes, the only final proofing I've really done in the proofer would be panettone, a couple of babkas, and I don't know. That's about it. It only fits one loaf of bread, and I'm always making at least 10, so it doesn't really function in that way for me. Maybe some milk buns or something I'll proof in there, but even donuts, you know, I'm not going to just make two donuts. I'm going to make 40. So it doesn't really function, but I have found that keeping my starter in the proofing chamber has actually been quite beneficial to both my bread and to my, starter. I will turn it off at night so that I can do the longer, a bit colder, but during the day, like right now, my starter is at 26 degrees. That's going to go into the dough that's autoleasing. And I have found that to be much more consistent, and that has been a very beneficial thing. But as far as the loaves go, I just do it wherever. I'm also used to working at the college with like a huge proofer. You can roll the rack right in. We've got like, there's five movable proofers plus a big proofer retarder plus a big deck oven. So it's very like just trying to figure out the environment. And I found that if I want to teach people how to bake at home, using a similar environment to home is better. Whereas if I'm doing everything in a Rothko oven and
that's in a proofer, so true.
Most people, that's very unapproachable. And if you're just a hobby weekend baker, you're not going to go out and spend all that money on those things.
Yeah, or they can replicate it at home, right? If you have all those fancy tools.
Yeah. Yeah.
Question there, you mentioned you were cold proofing your doughs. Sometimes when I let my doughs proof for longer than 24 hours in the fridge, I don't get as much oven spring anymore. Is this something you have observed too? What's the maximum time you can let your dough proof inside of the Benetton in the fridge?
I mean, another great question. So I think that it depends on many circumstances. So I would say, first of all, for anyone that's baking at home, a typical home, I'm going to talk in Celsius because I'm in Canada. I hope that's okay with you. You're the same, right?
Yes.
Sorry if there's any US viewers.
Sorry, Americans.
Yeah. And I actually learned everything in Fahrenheit, but I've made a mental point of trying to get out of Fahrenheit because no one really uses it. So a typical home fridge is anywhere from 3 to 4 degrees Celsius. Usually it's around 3.5 degrees Celsius. And now this is a food safe zone. So anything over 4 degrees Celsius is considered in the danger zone. And there's a certain range of temperatures for different products, but essentially a home fridge is meant to keep your meat, your dairy, everything in it. Whereas in a bakery, you're probably looking at somewhere between 8 and 10 degrees Celsius. And now it depends on the bakery, because if you have a very small bakery and you only have one fridge and you keep your bread and your dairy, you got to keep it colder. But if you design a proper bakery and you have a fridge allocated just for your doughs, you're going to be closer to 10 degrees Celsius. And that's going to decrease your final fermentation time. Mm-hmm. You've also got in a home fridge different spots in the fridge. So the colder spot might be on the bottom. It might be warmer near the door. And so it's all case by case. I've personally found that I think that around between 12 to 18 hours for the inoculations I do and for the length of ferment I do, it seems to be my beautiful spot. When I go higher in whole grain, I go on the lower end of that and I'll do more 10 to 12 hours and higher for it. I don't know for sure. This is something we should actually do a little bit of research on. I think that after a certain time, the gluten structure actually breaks down in the bread, and that's why you lose that. And I think what it is the acidity developing in the dough. And I mean, I got another crazy baking tool. I bought a pH pen. And so it might be an interesting experiment to actually take the pH of the dough when it goes in the fridge after 10 hours, after 14 hours, after 24 hours, and see if it's actually the pH or the acidity that's breaking down the gluten structure. If I had to guess, that's what I would say, but I'm not 100% on that. And so I think if you did a very low inoculation, you could probably go on the longer end, but you're still going to develop that acidity and you're still going to start to break down at about that 24 hour point. I have left breads in the oven, in the fridge for 36 hours and they baked fine. They were overly sour in my opinion, but I think 24 hours is pushing it. I think that we should, you know, I think you need to do a video on the pH of the dough. Yeah, oh, that, yes, that would be my guess, is the pH is breaking down.
Because I read some papers, actually a few papers mentioned that when you're below that 6 degrees Celsius, there shouldn't be any additional sourness developing inside of the bread. However, many bakers are saying that the longer proofing time inside of the fridge is going to make the bread a little bit more sour. But on my personal experiments, I was not able to notice this more sour taste. The ones which I proofed at room temperature had almost the same acidity inside in the end. Or maybe it's, of course, just my taste that I that's not so good. So I think what you mentioned, taking a tool like you have and just checking the acidity, that's the best thing.
It might also be beneficial to do an experiment with just the starter and, let's say, feed a starter, get it to its peak ripeness, and then put it in the fridge and smell it, because I think you'll see the expression of the acidity more in the just starter than the actual dough. So if you did both, and let's say we put a loaf in, we took the pH, but also a starter, and see how the pH changes of the starter as it sits in that cold environment.
Oh, that's a great idea.
I've heard that also, that it doesn't develop acidity, but I've from personal experience, just give me one second.
Yeah, take your time. But yeah, really interesting.
I've got...
Is that the dough?
I've always got a timer going. So yeah, I think from personal experience, I think that definitely you do develop more acidity. And it also could be, if you're not developing more acidity, you're eventually running out of that food. I mean, if you take a fresh fed starter and you put that in the fridge, it does take a while, but it doesn't stay at its peak for the whole time. Eventually it'll collapse and go watery. Sure. And so it's still moving. It's just very slow.
Oh, that's actually a very valid point. Yeah, if you take a starter and put it in the fridge, after a week or so, it's going to collapse again, right?
Yeah.
Yeah. Awesome. Yeah, I do have another amazing video of you, which I wanted to talk about with you. Actually, a few ones. And let's have a look at this one first. That's you scoring bread. And I think this just shows how often you already scored bread before, because that movement you have, it's just perfect. And I noticed you're always scoring more or less in the center, aren't you? And you're not scoring that deep as well.
Yeah, so I typically do in the center. I used to do off-centered. I've kind of gone more a little closer to the center with a little bit of an angle. And I've also... I used to do deeper scores, but what I've found recently is, so back to the higher hydration breads, when I'm doing like a really proofed higher hydration bread, I'm actually working on the high hydration 90% recipe for my website right now. And I'll do a YouTube video. I just got a camera yesterday so we can start doing YouTube. Yeah, it's pretty excited. So I've found that it really depends on the dough. So if you have a dough that's a little bit underproofed, or is lower hydration, you can do a deep score. But if you have a higher hydration bread that's like wobbling on the edge of being overproofed, that little shallow score is enough to open the tension so it can explode in the oven and bloom in the oven. And I don't think it needs to be deep. And the first time I actually saw that was at Tartine. I spent an afternoon just in the bakery and I was shocked at how shallow the score was. And I was like, okay, how is that gonna open in the oven? And their loaves are like, and so I tried it and I did a side by side and I realized, like, yeah, if you're doing like a well fermented, well hydrated bread, it really doesn't need to be that. But if the dough's on the drier side, you need a deeper score to it.
Okay. And you still score at a 45 degree angle more or less, or did I see that correctly?
Yeah, I usually do that 45 or so angle, and I use a very cheap, I use a very cheap, like, I think it cost me $7 Canadian for the thing with the blade. I replaced the blade. And so I often do, you know, if you're working in a bakery, you might have to change the blade 2, 3, even 4 times a night, depending on how big the bakery is. For me at the college, like, I'll maybe switch it once a week or twice a week or once a day, depending, you know, right now we're not baking as much, obviously, in the lab. And then at home, I mean, I bake a lot at home. I'm changing the blade fairly often, and I'll know right away. As soon as I hit the bread, I know instantly, like, ooh. And it's usually the first one, it kind of drags across. I'm like, oh, I should have changed that blade. But I just kind of, I don't know. I think it's that muscle memory. You just develop it. And I don't think I'm the best at it. I think I can definitely get better at it. So I'm always trying to consciously think about, well, what are the results that I want? Do I want it to open? I think if you open without the curve, again, I have never done a side-by-side. This would be an interesting video. If you do it without the curve, you open like this. Actually, I have done a side-by-side at the college, but you open more like this, whereas the angle, you open more like that.
Okay.
So you're going to get that more development out of an ear. And then if you even angle it a bit more, you kind of get it like that, where it opens on both sides and you get that kind of that double ear. So it's a little bit of trial and error. It's a little bit of knowing the loaf. The one I've been really working on lately is baguettes. I don't really get an opportunity to bake baguettes at home because it's hard to do them in a home oven with the size. And with the recent project we've been working on at the college, I've decided that every week I'm going to bake 50 so that I can really get that environment dialed in at the college and really get them to where I feel they should be. And that is the same thing. It's that weird angle away from the bread, and it's a bit of a challenge.
Do you proof them in colder temperatures as well, the baguettes, or are they proofed at room temperature?
So what I like to do is to finish the proof. So what I'm doing now is a baguette with poulish. They're yeasted. I'm going to start this week or maybe next week. I have to check my calendar of doing it with poulish and levain, because I want to get that little bit more flavor out of the flour. I think that with poulish, it's like very Parisian, but I don't think it's the best tasting bread ever. And so what I like to do is to finish them cold. So get them, say your final proof is 90 minutes, 60 minutes at room temp, and then 30 in the fridge. And it's just enough to cool it down, where it's easier to handle, easier to score. But typically I'm doing them room temp. The other one that I'm going to start doing is just doing the bulk cold. So rather than fermenting the final loaves, I'm going to bulk cold and then
that's interesting.
Shape, short bench, and final. Whereas with most sourdough, I prefer not to bulk cold. I prefer to bulk the loaves. I prefer to cold proof the loaves. So
when you say you bulk cold, is what temperature is that?
So I would do it just in a regular fridge around 3.5-4 degrees Celsius. So there's really not a lot of activity, but you are developing that flavor and that sort of like lengthened fermentation.
Okay. Interesting. Yeah, because I always have issues scoring my bread when they're proofed at room temperatures, and that's why I was asking. Is it the same for you?
Yeah, so it's definitely easier to handle cold bread. One thing that I've found that's helped me, so sometimes I do demos for either one-on-one lessons, for classes, for experiment, for whatever, and I show the ambient proof. But one thing I've found is if you really have to do an ambient proof, if you just stick the bread in the freezer for 20 minutes uncovered, you get that same skin on it, and it's cold and easier to handle, because I'm the same. It's harder to score. It's harder to handle. It's easier to degas. I also feel like it's harder to judge the proofing on. It sounds weird. It's harder to judge an ambient proofed bread than an actual cold fermented, because a cold fermented, an extra hour is not going to change the final structure that much. You know, 10 to 12 to 18 might be different, but you know, an extra half an hour is not going to change anything. Whereas an extra half an hour at ambient can be the difference between flat and full.
Yeah. Yeah. What I like to do when I proof at room temperature, I always give my dough a good rub with some flour, because I feel that dries out the surface a little bit, and that also makes scoring easier.
Interesting.
Plus the freezer hack you mentioned, that also really works very well.
I'd have to try that. Yeah, I haven't done it like that, but the freezers tends to work. It just depends on how much you're making. If you're a home baker, you've got room to throw one loaf. If you're trying to make a dozen, you can't really do that.
Yeah, I'm still working on my baguette recipe, because I also think it's incredibly hard to do them in a home oven.
Yeah, I'm going to start doing some demi baguettes in the Challenger pans. Just I've been doing them anyways, and then I'm working with a baker in the UK, and we're developing a digital baguette course for baguettes at home. And he's a silver medalist in the Coupe du Monde. For anyone that's watching that doesn't know, the Coupe du Monde is a baking competition that's held every other year in Paris, and it's really the it's by country, but it's really top level bakers, and he won a silver medal, and he's part of the Elite du Monde. And so the two of us have been working on this baguette at home course to try and make it more approachable for everyone, because it's challenging. And I think in a baguette, there's nowhere to hide. If you're making a classic baguette, there's only flour and fermentation, whereas you're adding rye or whole wheat, and it's more sour with sourdough, and it's a little easier to sort of like make a good tasting sourdough, but a good baguette is very difficult.
It's very challenging, right? Yeah.
Yeah. Often my students think it's the opposite. Often students come to the college and they think the baguettes is what they want to start with because it's easy. And I'm kind of like, baguettes is a week 12 skill once you've done other breads first, you know? And even then, I think it takes a lifetime of trying to make them to get really good at it.
Yeah. My next question is, so I saw you working with a lot of dough at college. And I have a small video on that as well. Let me just put that on the screen here. And that looks amazing. My question would be here, what do you have to change when you work on a larger scale? I mean, at home, you might be making one or two breads at the same time, but there, that was enough dough for, I don't know, maybe 10, 20, 30 breads, right? What do you have to change when you increase the scale of the production?
So the first thing, I guess, that's great. Again, you're very good at asking questions, I'm going to say.
They're
great
Thank questions. You.
So the first thing, and again, I'm going to reference my friend Michael in Germany again, because again, this guy's taught me, you know, so much. And I remember having the conversation with him about, you know, sort of baking at home versus bakery. And the biggest thing that the biggest takeaway I had from that conversation was, it's more about managing fermentation in the bakery. So when you're working on a larger scale and you have multiple doughs on the go, it's all about the timing. And now that particular video, I was only making one bread that day because the college is closed. We're just doing our charity bakes. But I think that when you're on that larger scale, you have to have more factors in mind. So for example, you know, If I do, so on my breads at home, I typically do a very long bench rest. So I'm doing about 45 to 60 minutes bench rest. I think most recipes would give 20 minutes. When you're in a bakery, if you're shaping 100 loaves of bread, it takes you half an hour to pre-shape those breads, or depending on how many people are on the pre-shaping table, it can take 20 to 60 minutes. And so there is no rest period, because by the time you've pre-shaped, the first dough you pre-shaped is ready to final shape. Mm-hmm. Then you also have to factor in the oven. So if you can only fit, you know, if you have, at the college we have 4 decks, I can bake 16 baguettes per deck. And so if I only had 2 decks, I have to now manage the fermentation, and that I need to be able to bake the first and then the next and then the next. And so I think a lot of it comes down to managing fermentation, which impacts your temperature. So in my experience, a larger mass of dough has a larger thermal mass and gives off more temperature. It also is subject to more friction factor in the mixer. Mm-hmm. So you have to keep those things in mind. When you're making a dough at home, you know, if you have enough dough to fill, like, let's say something like this, or, you know, mm-hmm. you've got your sourdough in here or whatever, it's in my house, which is 72 degrees Fahrenheit, or, you know, probably about 22 degrees Celsius. And so when you have that big amount of dough, you have to keep in mind that the temperatures are going to either go up or they're going to be warmer. I also have found that larger masses of dough, as I had mentioned, generate more friction factor. But in my experience, so when you mix a dough by hand, the temperature kind of goes like this and then goes colder if your room is colder. So by the time mm-hmm. you finish bulk, you're maybe 2 or 3 degrees lower. So if I want a DDT of 26, I'll aim for, if I want a final dough temp of 26, I'll aim for a desired dough temperature out of the mixer of, let's say, 28, so that it can kind of come down. Whereas when you mix a large batch on a spiral mixer, especially if you're doing an improved mix or intensive, you're going to actually go up. And so your dough comes off the mixer, but it keeps going up, 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 up. And you'll find that even with small mixers like this one here, they go mm-hmm. up. So I think that's the first thing, is the management of fermentation. The beauty of it is you get muscle memory and repetition very quickly. And so to go back to what you said about the scoring, it looks like you've done this a lot. If you think about a home baker, I used to always use this analogy for cooks. So let's say I used to teach private cooking classes. I still do, not as often because now it's baking classes. But, you know, I had someone who I taught how to cook salmon. And he said, mm-hmm. how come yours is always just so much better? When I see you do it, it's just so perfect. I said, look,
okay.
I work the fish station in a Michelin restaurant that does 200 people for dinner. I'm cooking anywhere from 50 to 120 pieces of fish per day. You're cooking 1, 2, maybe 3 per week. So in one day, I cook more than you cook in 1 year. And the same thing is for bread. In one shift at a bakery, all you're doing is shaping and you're only on the shaping table and that's it. Whereas at home, you're doing it all, but smaller scale. So I think that managing that fermentation, learning how to do it, getting that repetition in is the biggest part of scaling up. If you were talking about scaling up for home bakers, it's a little bit easier because you can sort of double. But I think it really ultimately comes down to, yeah, managing fermentation and really managing your schedules and your times.
Okay. Yeah, makes sense. And now back to that proofing and scoring part. I saw you using a special kind of Benetton that I've never seen before. I just wanted to ask you what this is about. Let me put that on the screen again. First of all, interesting shaping technique you have there. That was a little bit different from what you normally do, or?
Yeah, so that's just like essentially what I've done is I've pre-shaped the dough, I've let it relax on the table, and I've just folded it in half in the basket.
Okay. So yeah, but no, then it's not going to have as much strength, right?
No, it still can. So what I've done is I've actually mixed it longer. So when you're mixing dough by hand, you're typically not developing the strength as you would in the mixer. And so, you know, the dough that's in my mixer right now, it's probably going to mix for about 15 to 20 minutes. Whereas most people aren't really doing that by home. You know, you're not really, even if the recipe says, I mean, I don't know how many viewers are in here right now, but if you're watching this and you think about it, if you read a recipe that says mix for 10 minutes, are you actually mixing it for 10 minutes? Or are you mixing it for kind of 8 and then you're tired and you move on? And that's what I do. I'm like, yeah, like, I don't actually put a timer and say, oh, it's been 10 minutes, stop. I mean, maybe some of you do, but I think that it's kind of like, and so there's just thousands of ways to do it. There's thousands of ways to shape a loaf. There's stitching, there's cinching, there's rolling. There's just so many ways. And that's just one that I learned at a bakery in Paris called 10 Bells, and they actually eliminated their final shape and they just started doing that. And so I started trying it and I found that I can get good results, but it does require longer mixing or more folds. And then a fold towards the end of the
okay.
So that you still have that tension, that strength. And if you saw that video, I was kind of wiggling it.
Mm-hmm.
To finish it. It was, they actually probably should have rested a bit longer, but I had to kind of cheat it and stick it together.
Okay. And the Benetton, what kind of material was that? It didn't look like the regular Benettons.
You want me to grab one? I'll show you. It'll just take me one
second. Oh yes, please, please. So very interesting Benettons. I've not seen them before, but I've seen other people using them more recently. So I'm very curious.
So ironically, I guess, these are actually made in Germany, and these are wood pulp Benettons. So they are, if you look at it, you can almost see that they're layered and they're pressed.
Yes.
So it's a pressed wood pulp Benetton. It's almost like if you've ever worn a cast. Do you know what a cast feels like? It almost feels like what a cast is.
Okay.
These ones have a waffle pattern in them. Sorry, I've got a big light on. You can't really see it. Can you see inside there?
Mm-hmm.
Well, so these ones have a waffle pattern, and they actually will leave that pattern on the final dough, provided you flour them properly. And so I picked these up. This is something I saw Michael doing when I was in Germany, and he was using these baskets, and I was kind of like, where did you get those? And now at the college, the program, when they developed the bread program, they hired somebody to like kind of consult on, this is 6 years ago, to kind of consult on what equipment should we get. And they got what I think to be very cheap Thanatones, which in some ways makes sense because it's college, there's a lot of students, and obviously everything's on a budget. But I thought that if we really want to prepare students for industry, we should be using something that's industry standard and that's durable. And so the wicker baskets, I brought one of mine to school. I asked one of the students to bang it out and he was like, sure. And it like busted right in half. And so right there I knew, well, we probably can't use those. So we got these because they're durable. They're less likely to mold if you dry them out. You have to sort of like dry them a little bit. If I was in a bakery, I would actually put them in an oven at a very, 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 very low temperature. They're made out of sustainable ingredients or sustainable. They're sustainable baskets. They're cheaper. So the only thing for me is they're not necessarily cheaper because I have to pay for shipping. But if you lived in Germany or even in Europe, they'd probably be cheaper. I think they're about 4 or 5 euros.
Okay. And would you say they are better in case you have a very sticky dough, or is a regular banter with a linen better?
So I think that the traditional coil Banatone is better for a drier dough. And so what I have for mine is I have a whole bunch here. Like I've probably got about 50 different ones. And so I have the coiled. I put a, it almost looks like a shower cap, but like it's like a linen thing that fits in it. Mm-hmm. And then I have another style of Banatone that I could show you if you want, but they have, it's a wicker basket with the stitched in sort of couche or the stitched in linen. Mm-hmm. I think that they both work very well. I don't necessarily think one is different from the other, but with this, when I turn it out, the bread just like falls out of it. There's no like, you know, sometimes you got to kind of get your hand in there, and this I've never had an issue with these, even when they were brand new. I dust them with a combination of, so I use rice flour, rye flour, and coarse bran. And I used to only use rice flour, but I don't like the look or the taste. I don't really like the way that that rice flour tastes. So I picked that up at San Francisco Baking Institute. They use rice flour, rye, and bran. And I found that it adds this like cool texture. It looks really rustic and I really like it. And so you can probably see that it looks like there's brown stuff in there. It's only because I did a bake yesterday. Yeah, you can see it moving. I did a bake this one. I haven't quite cleaned them out. I don't want to say they're better, but I've been really enjoying them. And maybe that's just a baker with a fancy new tool, but I've been favoring these over my other baskets.
Okay, interesting. And now as a German, there's one thing that I think all the other Germans and probably also Scandinavians can relate. You had this one recipe, and that was a rye chocolate sandwich bread. I just need to put up the video and you need to tell me about this masterpiece. That's delicious. Gotta be the perfect sandwich bread. What is that masterpiece?
So I actually would say it's more, so I think I may have called it bread. I think it's more of a cake. And this is an old recipe from Alain Ducasse. So Alain Ducasse is a very famous chef with like multiple 3 Michelin star restaurants in France and all over the world. And he has a book called Le Livre de Grand Cuisine. And there's one for pastry and one for cooking. And I was actually just flipping through I like to look through books at night and like everybody, we read cookbooks at night or baking books. And I saw that recipe and it had been on my table for a while, but we don't really, outside of some of our sourdoughs, we don't really use a lot of white flour at home. So anything that you would see, you know, I don't want to say you can't, but there's some things that you kind of need one white flour for. I don't want to say you can't because you can definitely make a croissant out of whole wheat flour, but in my personal experience, they're not as good as the white flour counterpart. And so my wife doesn't really eat a lot of white flour. She eats only 100% rye breads. And so the real reason for that was to make that sort of cake, that soft, delicious chocolatey, but pair it with rye because rye and chocolate go very well. And now there is a very small portion of all-purpose flour in that formula, but we are going to make it again soon and remove it. And I don't know, anyone that's watching this, it's a great recipe to make. It bakes very low temperature, so it's super moist inside. It's made with coconut oil, so it's got this like coconut flavor with that deep chocolate richness, and then the rye kind of enhances the chocolate. It's really, really nice.
I need to try this.
And maybe it's false advertising by saying bread. I think it's more of like a cake, but it's you could do either with it.
And here also, this was also one of the rye breads that I found on your channel. I've never seen a rye bread with such an amazing crumb. How do you go about rye flour? What are your secrets?
So, great question. This bread is a 100% Natchi Leaven rye bread. And so I keep two starters at home. One is rye, one is sort of, for a long time I did 50-50 whole wheat white flour. Recently I've switched over to 90-10 white flour and rye. And this is, I'm talking recently, like within the past 3 months, because I feel like I get a better length out of it. Whereas with the whole wheat, it sours faster. And now I'm just so busy, I can't manage. So anyways, that bread is actually an interesting one because it has started several arguments on my personal Instagram feed because it's actually made with boiling water. And so the fermentation, you're taking the rye starter and we're mixing that and we're letting that do our leaven build. So the majority of the fermentation is in the actual build as opposed to with your standard country bread, you know, you're mixing the dough and that goes for a long time. And so you build a starter, boil water, you put the flour on top of the starter and you pour boiling water and mix it in. And what happens is the boiling water and the temperature of the thing kind of meet in the middle. And so you never actually hit that zone where you're going to kill the yeast. I don't know the actual temperature. I think it's about 110 Fahrenheit, which I'm not sure in Celsius, but there's an actual temperature that would kill the yeast, but you never really hit that because the flour kind of acts like a buffer and we're putting a larger percentage of the hydration in the build. And so rather than doing a sort of stiff starter and building it out, it's a very wet starter. So the percentages, I guess, would be, so it's about 400 grams of water and 300 grams of flour. So I don't know, I'm not the best on math right now, but we're talking about a well hydrated starter. So we're not adding that much water to the final product. It's about a 95 to 100% hydration bread. And when you add that boiling water, we're actually gelatinizing the starches in the rye flour. And that's what gives us that nice open crumb structure. I don't want to say open crumb, but it is quite open, right?
Yeah. And I mean, the crust also looks perfect. It looks so rustic.
There is a, there's a few variations of that recipe. So it's way back on my feed, but we've done, we do about 200 grams of inclusions per 800 grams of dough, which is one loaf is 800 grams. So we've done it with dehydrated apples. We've done it with fried onions. And then the original recipe for that formula was developed by my friend who's the head baker of the School of Artisan Food in Nottingham. And he did a version with pink peppercorns and prunes. And the reason is they have a cheese called Stilcherton, which is a raw milk Stilton, which is produced on the estates where the bakery is. And they made the bread specifically to pair with the raw milk cheese. And so pink peppercorn and prune with that. And so I learned the bread from him and then I took it my own direction. And so you can add 10% spelt, 20% spelt. There's actually a full recipe from around December 15th on my Instagram. And I think I'm going to put that into my first digital course, which I've been working on sort of every night after my daughter goes to bed. And I think I'm going to do that one because I'd really like to show how easy it is. And now, you know, I'm offering it as in like, hey, I'm putting this in a digital course that I'm creating, but it's also available for free on my Instagram. So like, if you just want to take the recipe and try it out, you can. But I think it's just such a great bread. It very quickly became a staple in my house. And one that we eat more than sort of anything. I haven't been baking it as much recently. But yeah, it's very excellent. I'm sure, you know, you're in Germany. What part of Germany are you in?
In Hamburg in the north. We also love rye.
And the north is more traditional for that style of rye bread than the south, is it not? In the more sort of northern Baltics, which is where rye would grow, is it not?
Exactly. I would say even in Scandinavia, probably rye bread is the only bread you eat. Yeah. So rye bread is really popular here.
I did learn. So when I lived in Denmark, I was lucky enough to work at a restaurant called Noma. And I did learn a lot of traditional rye breads through that time. And it's just the only funny thing with that bread is if I bake breads for my micro bakery group, and let's say I do 20 sourdoughs and 10 rye breads, I struggle to sell the rye breads because in Canada, it's not very popular. And so the people that buy the rye bread are actually people from that live in Canada that are from Germany. There's a girl from Germany. There's one guy from Austria, and they love it. And then most of the other people are like, what is this? And what I started doing is I would give them a loaf with their purchase so that the next time they would buy it. But it's a hard sell to sell that kind of bread here.
Yeah, I have the same issue on my YouTube channel. So of course I need to plan a little bit what kind of content I want to produce. And I mean, I personally love rye bread, but internationally, I would say rye doesn't have the same reputation as a wheat bread does.
Yeah.
Maybe I should give every viewer a free rye bread.
Yeah, if you want, I'll send you that recipe. And if you want to make it, you can let me know what you think. You can do a video on it. It's very simple. I'm happy to share it with you.
Yeah, please. That would be awesome. And so I also saw, you mentioned that before, that you're doing pizza. And I saw this one amazing video on your channel, which I also wanted to share. And let me just put that live. First of all, is that oven at your house?
Yeah, that's in my backyard. I will say that I was a little self-conscious posting that video because the fire is a little too hot. So for that style of pizza, yes, you want an open flame, but that was like really hot. And I was just like, whatever, let's just film it. And so for anyone watching, it's a little bit too much flame there, but whatever. You can't make... One thing I think I've found that's hard to get over is when you go from working professionally in a restaurant, especially for a chef like Daniel Blude, to like either creating content or teaching, you can make everything perfect. And I think that that's been my biggest holdback for a long time. My wife, who is incredible, and she's helped me organize all the baking and planning and really helped me with the website that we developed. You know, I think I held back from doing a website because I was never happy. And I was like, well, this pizza's not perfect, so should I really share the recipe? But I don't think you're never going to get perfect. It's never going to be there. So with that said, the pizza oven is in our backyard. We do, I don't want to say only, because actually for Super Bowl, I did some yeasted pizzas. But usually I don't usually cook with yeast at home. I almost do everything sourdough. And so in the summer, what started off happening was we were doing pizzas for sort of neighbors and whatever. And then I was doing it a little bit bigger and we would do some private parties. Like if my wife's friend wanted to have her birthday, they'd come over and I'd cook pizzas for everyone and like kind of hang out. Then because of COVID, we stopped. But what I've started doing recently is just kind of like, we'll cook the pizza, box it, and then take it out to the neighbor. You know, we've got this house, that house. They're all in my little bread group. And so we do them fairly often. I'll usually do, I think we do probably between 20 and 35 pizzas at a time. And it's just me cooking and stretching and everything. Naturally leavened. I really started doing pizza through consulting. So a lot of places I've been consulting with, namely one is Maker Pizza, which is located in Toronto. Maker Pizza has been rated as the best pizza in Toronto for several years by like all the local publications. And so I started with them on a consult and then they kind of brought me on as the culinary director. And now I'm very busy. And so as much as they've given me that title, I think more what it is just a little bit of ongoing consulting. So if they have questions, and I really sort of, it's something I've been doing for about a decade and I've just been refining and working and working and working. When I worked for Daniel Blude, I used to go on my days off to a Toronto pizza place that does wood fired. And I used to spend the first time I went was because I wanted to learn how to bake bread in a wood oven. And I thought, hey, if I go to the pizza place, I'll see how you use the wood oven and then I'll just take that, what I learned, and bake pizza. But it's actually totally different. And a pizza is totally different from a bread oven. And I had no idea. And so I very quickly learned. And then my first day, they let me stretch the dough. And within about 10 minutes, I got thrown off the line. And I'm coming from a sous chef, from a very good chef. And I thought like, and they were like, buddy, you're way too slow. And I kind of just made a point of going back every week and just really learning it. And I think that pizza is a whole unique thing on its own. I think it's a whole nother world. I think that many, you know, there's bread pizza. Like people make bread and then they make their pizza. Or if you go to your local bakery and they've got the slab and they cut you a square, not Roman style, but more like that thick style pizza. But then there's that real kind of like pizza you just saw in the video. And it's just a very big passion of mine. I was able to represent Canada at the World Pizza Expo. I was supposed to compete this year in the nationals, but it got postponed. Last year. Hopefully they'll do something this year. And it's just been something we've been working on. This morning, I actually was on another call and I've been invited to do a demo at this year's International Pizza Exposition, which is going to be held virtually. And so I'll demo something to do with sourdough pizzas. I'm not quite sure yet.
When you do your sourdough pizza, do you shape the dough balls right away like they do in a traditional Neapolitan pizza? Or do you bulk ferment your dough together and then divide in the end to form your pizza balls?
For a regular pizza, I often shape them right away or maybe an hour for yeasted pizzas. For sourdough, I typically do a longer bulk fermentation. And so I've done both where I'll make the dough, give it some floor time, put it in the fridge, take it out, shape it, cook it that day. More often than not, what I prefer to do is to do a bulk fermentation, maybe one fold, maybe two, depending on the dough. And then I'll shape the dough and then I'll cold ferment the dough as a shaped ball. And that's sort of my preferred. I found it with sourdough, I really need a little bit of floor time to sort of get the yeast activated and start the fermentation. Even if I'm going for 24 to 70, let's say 48 hours in the fridge. If I shape those balls right away, they're still very tight. They're not really fermented very well when I go to use them.
Do you think there's more room for pizzerias to sell sourdough pizzas? Because almost every pizzeria right now, at least where I live, they would just do yeast-based pizza. But I've never really seen a sourdough-based pizza in a big restaurant.
Great question. There's one in Toronto that does only sourdough. There's two actually that I can think of that do only sourdough. I think that it's more difficult. I think it's harder to train your staff, but I think that anything that you do in a restaurant or pizzeria is difficult when you begin. So when you first open a pizzeria, whether you're doing yeasted or sourdough, it's difficult. Learning the fermentation, how to manage the dough, it's difficult. So if you just start from the beginning with your natural leaven, I think it's fine. I think it does take a little bit more skill from the cooks and it takes a little bit more understanding. And that might be the reasoning behind it, because at the end of the day, you're not really making any more money. And so using that example for our micro bakery, we produce almost always sourdough goods. But we do say if we're doing something yeasted. And so I'll do sourdough bagels, but sometimes I'll also do yeasted bagels because my wife is pregnant. We have a 3-year-old and she wants bagels in 3 hours and she doesn't want to wait 48 hours. So when you're talking about space, usage, and all of those things, I think that it can be very challenging, but if it's done correctly, it can be quite great. And then the other side of that is I have never really done a side by side on this, but I think that your doughs will hold longer at a smaller inoculation of yeast than sourdough. So for example, when you're running a restaurant, let's say a very small pizzeria, we're making 200 pizzas a day and that's it. But if we only sell 150 today, I don't want to throw the dough out. I want to carry that into tomorrow. Whereas a low yeast inoculation, I can carry those on for up to 5 days. Whereas sourdough, I think that by the time you hit the 5 day, it's going to be, as we talked about with the bread starting to break down. And I think it's a little bit more challenging to schedule. But again, if you look at Anthony Falco, he's a pizza consultant based out of the US. He's probably the most well-known in the world, I think. There's two main sort of pizza consultants in the US that are very big. And Anthony has based his whole sort of consulting off of natural leaven pizzas and natural leaven and how to do it and teaching and going in and teaching people how to really do it. So I think there's room for it. It's probably something you're going to see more and more of, and it's probably something that's going to happen more and more. And I think what's really driving it is bakers that are doing pizza and they're really starting. And if you look at the old Neapolitan, there's a really good book. I have it. I can't remember the name, but it's a VPN book about VPN pizza and the classifications. And I mean, if you read about the traditional Neapolitan pizzas, a lot of them were naturally leavened and a lot of them had a low inoculation overnight fermentation. And same thing in Rome, because they didn't have fridge space. They didn't have space to house the doughs. They weren't able to do it. So I think that's something you'll start to see more and more of, but I do think it's a little bit more challenging. With that said, I think it's more rewarding. And in my opinion, I think you can charge a little bit more for it. And maybe that's a misconception and maybe I don't want to give wrong information. But personally, you know, for my micro bakery, I'll charge a little bit less for yeasted products than I do for sourdough. So if I make two bagels, I'll charge $1 more for the sourdough version than the yeasted version. But
makes people
sense. Know what they're yeah. buying and they know what they're getting into. And it's my job to educate, whether it's my students, whether it's my bakery customers or whatever, it's my job to educate them and say, look, you know, this is yeasted. It takes 3 hours. This is why the price is cheaper than the sourdough version.
Yeah. I always had this plan to open up a pizzeria and I would just make a basic pizza margherita, but then you could choose between three different doughs. You could choose yeast dough, Polish dough, and then just the sourdough. So pretty much just the simple topping, but then three different doughs to compare. Because yeah, I think if you taste the sourdough pizza, the taste is slightly different, but I also feel that it's a little bit more digestible. If you eat it, you don't feel so yep. destroyed after eating it. Whereas with the yeast-based pizza, it can sometimes feel a little bit heavy.
Yeah, I think if you do a yeasted pizza very well, like when we're talking about the very top ones, they can be very light in the crust, but you still feel it after. And I guess the same thing for sourdough, you know, just because it's a sourdough pizza, it doesn't mean it's better. And I think that, so, you know, maybe I'm going to get some backlash for saying this, but I've actually, you know, my name on Instagram comes up as Sourdough Duffy. And most of what I post, almost everything I post is sourdough. And I've chosen to do that for niche purposes, for content purposes, for SEO optimization purposes. But I think that there is a misconception. I don't think all yeasted products are bad. And I think that just because it's sourdough, it doesn't make it better. You know, like just because you're making sourdough pizza, it does not mean that it's better than a yeasted pizza. And just because it's a yeasted pizza doesn't mean it's better. You still have to get the basic fundamentals right, you know?
Yeah, makes sense. Okay, amazing. Thank you so much. I just wanted to give the audience also the chance because they could ask some questions in advance. I just wanted to run a few awesome questions that the viewers asked by you. And I think this one was a really great question by Jose Gomez Gil. I hope I pronounced your name correctly. I'm sorry if not. Why and when to use a 65% hydration over a 100% hydration starter? As far as I know, for instance, a Lievito Madre from Italy would be similar to regular starter, but it would just be less in hydration. Me personally, I've always only worked with 100% hydration starter. Have you ever worked with a stiffer starter yourself?
Yeah, just 1 second.
Mm-hmm. Oh, and now he's probably going to bring us this amazing Lievito Madre. I'm very curious. And there you go. Okay, so nice.
So this is a stiff starter that I'm using for my 100% whole wheat bread. And so I don't have, so again, I don't want to say wrong information. And I'm very careful of what I say because I think there's a lot of misinformation out there. And there's a lot of bakers that say things like, oh, take my digital course because sourdough bread's the healthiest in the world. But do you really know that? Do you really have the evidence to prove that? Have you really... You know, yeah. A lot of people make these claims so they can sell a product. And so I'm not trying to make a claim, but I think personally that the stiffer starter is good when you're trying to develop a stronger dough. So for example, when I'm trying to get more strength into my whole wheat dough, I use a stiff starter. I also think that you're having a different balance of acid. So one thing that I really learned over the holidays with this pH pen is that you can have the perfect pH for your pasta madre or for your levain for panettone, but it still doesn't produce the product you want. And that's because in different starters, there's a balance of acetic and lactic acids. And so I don't quote me on this, but I think for most sourdoughs, what you're looking at is about four parts lactic, one part acetic acid. And with something like panettone, you want four part lactic, one part acetic, because you're trying to develop more sweet notes and the lactic will bring forth more of the sweet notes of the flour, like yogurty smell, and acetic will be more vinegar. So with flavor and strength, I think are two options. So for me, to actually sort of answer that, I'll use a 65% hydration when I know I need added dough strength and when I want to sort of alter the acidity of the final flavor of the dough. 100% whole wheat is very strong tasting, and so I can manage a little bit more acid in the dough. this is definitely something that I should look more into, because I don't want to say the wrong thing, but I think that that's a very good base starting point. It would be an interesting side by side to do. Mm-hmm. To see the difference in what I've found is, so I work with a colleague of mine, Nick Stacy. He's a phenomenal baker. We've been working together for about 10 years. He's not really a social media guy, but what he did was he took my recipe from my website for 100% whole wheat bread. And then he started making other recipes with the same levain. So this is 100% whole wheat levain. And he started making his basic country and his oat porridge. And he found that he was getting a better expression and more open crumb on the stiff starter versions of those breads. And now we don't have, you know, like scientific paper behind it. We didn't do any pH testing. That's just him baking at home and sending me pictures. But it looks to both of us that he's getting a better expression of that crumb through the stiff starter.
Yeah, I think it also shows there's just so much more room for scientific exploration, right? What, there's so many variables, parameters to test.
Yeah, there really is. There really is. And it doesn't mean that just because he used the stiff starter, the crumb was more open. Maybe it was just he mixed it better. Who knows? Like, I don't really know.
Yeah. Awesome. And thank you so much, Jose. And then Jules asked the question, what would be the best way to improve certain flavors in the final bread, such as sourness? I think that's what many people are chasing for, to make a more sour bread.
Oh, that's funny. I just saw in the comments a heart comment from Nick Stacy. He's actually here with us right now. Shout out to Nick. He's a phenomenal baker. He's helped me improve my baking so much. He has been a key part of developing this program at the college. We haven't touched too much on some of the projects we've done, but I mean, he's been really instrumental in getting that done. So thank you, Nick.
There he is. Hi, Nick.
So as far as the sourness goes in your loaf, I would start, first of all, playing around with different builds. And so over a longer period of time, we will develop a more acid final product. And, you know, with speaking to one of my friends who was a baker at Tartine, they do a very young levain and they mix it under fermented. So a lot of the books tell you to reach the peak and then mix your dough, whereas they're going a little bit under because they're trying to coax more sweet notes out of their bread and they're not trying to promote the sour. So if you really want to promote the sour, I just saw a really good post from Foolproof Baking on Instagram about this, but you can do different inoculations and longer fermentations, and that'll really help promote that sour flavor. Even when you smell a starter that's been sort of overnight. And then I've also found that if I really want to increase the sourness in my loaf, I can add whole wheat to my levain. So if I'm doing 50% whole wheat, 50% bread flour versus 100% bread flour, I find I get much more acetic acid and much more sour notes in my final product.
Okay, that's very interesting. Yeah, actually, now that you mention it, I always only use a whole wheat or a whole rye starter. I never bake with a bread flour based starter.
So one of the reasons to bake with a bread flour starter, and I think this probably comes from bakeries, is it's cheaper. It's cheaper to build your, in general, not everywhere in the world and not everyone has it, but in general, it's cheaper to use white flour than whole wheat flour. And so I think a lot of places use it because it's cheaper and it's easier to work with.
Okay. And now going back to this question, you said you have to ferment for a little bit longer, but that also means that you need to choose a different flour, right? Because not every flour allows you to ferment for a very long time. In my own experiments, you would need to have a high gluten flour that allows you to ferment over a longer period of time, because else it might just get sticky too fast and you won't have that sour taste.
It's hard for me because I only really get higher gluten flours because of everything I use. Even the all-purpose flour that I get here is pretty strong and you could make a pretty good bread of it. I think by doing that, what you could do is decrease the inoculation. So if you're usually doing your bulk fermentation for about 3 hours, you could do it for 5, but with a little bit less starter and you'll still develop those acid notes.
Okay.
This is something that I've been planning on writing a guide for on my website. And so maybe what I'll do is a little bit more side by side and I'll really try and get that answer for Jules a little better.
Okay, awesome. Next question, which I think is a really great question, also related to what you are doing with your bread education. Tips for baking with freshly milled whole grain flour. Will larger particles of germ or bran cut the gluten strands? This is something that I've read everywhere on the internet as well, but couldn't confirm in my own experiments. So I'm curious to hear your opinion about this.
Great question, Rachel. So in my personal opinion, again, a lot of going back to that recipe with the rye bread where I baked it with the boiling water, somebody said, well, that doesn't work because your boiling water in that recipe doesn't work. So I private messaged her and I said, look, why don't you try the recipe? And she said, well, I'm not trying that recipe because it's not backed by science and it doesn't work. Like, here's a picture of the bread. It works. It's very good. And anyways, and so with this question, this is not something, again, that I have actually like actual proof of, but in my experiments and my trials and errors, what I've found to be is not as much the so will the larger germ or brand cut the gluten strand? So first of all, when I mill flour at the college, it's a very large mill and I can mill it quite fine. I can actually show you because I've got the flour right here. And so this is the whole wheat that I'm actually working with right here. Mm-hmm. And so you can see it's fine.
Very and finely milled.
Mm-hmm. If I squeeze that in my hand, you can see it stays as a clump and it's got good oils and good. And you don't really see those huge particles of the bran. And so when I started working with fresh milled flour, I was at a bakery in Vermont called Elmore Mountain Bread. The owners are husband and wife, and he actually is the founder, creator of New American Stone Mills, which is the flour mill we have. And so I asked Andrew, you know, the same question, don't the large bran act like a knife and they cut the gluten as it's mixing? And what he told me was it's actually not the way. What really happens is those brands are actually cutting the air pockets or the CO2 pockets that are caused by fermentation. And so it's not the mixing that's breaking down the gluten. It's in that rising stage. Think of a bubble that's blowing up, blowing up, blowing up. And once it gets to its maximum, it's very thin. Whereas if you, a balloon. If you blow up a balloon halfway, it's tough. When you blow it up all the way, it can be broke very easily. And so as it expands, 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 that's when it hits that bran and that's when it collapses. So his explanation to me was if you want to get into more higher whole grain bread such as this, you need to do a longer mix. And it comes with developing more gluten so that you can withstand that expansion and you can withstand that sharp point. But it's not necessarily the germ or bran cutting the gluten strands during the mixing period. And again, I could be totally wrong on that, but that's my educated guess.
Okay, no, very interesting. One thing that I learned when I was visiting a mill in southern Germany, a big mill, she would tell me, the miller would tell me that it's important that for whole wheat that they mill it twice or so just to cut down the bran a little bit. The more finely milled the whole wheat flour is, the more similar it is in terms of baking properties to a bread flour or so. So
yeah, we found that with the mill at the college, the finer milled that the flour is, the better we can hydrate the flour, the more it'll absorb, the more water it'll absorb, but also the more strength we can develop. I do see someone that said, how do you work with lower protein flour? So what I do is I just use less water.
Okay, that makes sense. Yeah. So yeah, I think that's also a common misconception. Based on the flour you have to adjust your hydration level, right? You shouldn't just follow a recommendation blindly. It depends on what you have.
And that really goes back to that high hydration that we were talking about earlier. I had mentioned that someone had said like, oh, well, it's just bakers showing off. But I think ultimately when we're talking about hydration of flour and doughs, it's more about properly hydrating your flour. So I have very, very strong flour. If you go on my website on the recipes, I've started to write the actual specs of the flour so you can see what the protein is. I didn't do it on the beginner recipe, but on the 50-50, there's a 50-50 sourdough recipe and 100% whole wheat recipe. It says what the flour is, what the protein is. I haven't quite got into following numbers on the website yet, but I will. But I think that it has a lot to do with that as well.
Yeah. Awesome. Yeah, I'm just looking at time now. We are already talking for 1 hour and 30 minutes. It feels like it's only been 5 minutes because it's been so interesting. I wanted to end this by just showing one more amazing video of you. I hope everybody is hungry now. That looks insane.
It's so funny, the things that do well on social media. So I posted that video on both TikTok and Instagram. And I think on TikTok, it was like 1.6 million. And on Instagram, it's 1.3 million. So it's like 2.9 million views. And after we filmed it, I said to my wife, I'm like, I don't know, the angle's a bit weird. And so you can see that the bread doesn't actually fill out the pan. I put 1,100 grams of dough, and I'm actually blaming Nick Stacey, who's in this room right now, because he told me 1,000, but I think it actually needs 1,300 grams for that dough, for that pan. And so it was a little bit less than it should be, and I just did it anyways, and it goes crazy.
And was it delicious in the end?
Yeah, very good, very good. So the actual dimpling effect like that, a lot of people were asking me, like, why did you do that? And I just learned that from Michael in Germany, and his explanation was it just is a different way of doing it. Like, you see people just kind of doing whatever, but there's no reason or rhyme to it. And if you ask someone, why do they dimple focaccia, they probably really don't know. But what we're trying to do is press through to the bottom of the dough to expand those air pockets into smaller spaces to get that more balanced open crumb. Think that's kind of the behind the scenes. And then when you add that with funny Russian music, it goes viral.
Yeah, Matthew, it has been really awesome chatting with you. Thank you so much for giving me the opportunity. I learned so much, and this was really amazing. I think what you're working on is also truly unique. Keep doing what you're doing. You are making this world truly a better place by enabling people to bake everywhere. I think it's just great what you're doing.
Thank you so much. Thank you. Yeah, this has been awesome. It's been a very quick hour and 45 minutes. I didn't realize it was so fast. I do see someone that said, can you link the rye bread recipe? I cannot find it in the Instagram. So I can, if you send me a DM, I will, if you just message me, I'll send you the post, because it's there. It's just in a video format. It's maybe difficult to find. And then I will also work on it for the way. If you scroll down, I can show it to you.
Yeah, I can't scroll down here now because that's just a picture, but I think it should be inside of your feed.
Yeah,
right?
If you DM me, I can find it to you. I can kind of put it on. And I mean, amazing that people come out and listen to this. I just love sharing bread. I love talking about bread. I like doing it. It's really become, it's something that for me started off as kind of a pastime hobby, and then it became kind of an obsession, and it became very, you know, it's my full time now. It's my full time life. I mean, I'm living it. I'm doing it. I'm learning every day. I'm making mistakes all the time. I'm getting better all the time. I get bakers that ask me a question, and they start off with, "Hey, sorry to ask you this question, but," and what they don't know is I'm asking the same questions on the other end. I'm asking other bakers so many questions. You know, I'm pretty sure at some points my friend there in Germany, I'm pretty sure at some points he just turns his notifications off for me, because I'm always sending him pictures. I'm always asking questions, and I feel like in some ways it's almost it feels weird to teach. Because I feel like I'm very much still learning. I feel like I'm still so new to this. I feel like I'm still learning. I feel like I'm still making those, you know, those steps. But I think that that's the best part about this kind of bread baking, is that it's an endless journey. You'll never know it all. If you ever see a baker that tells you they know it all, then do not listen to them, because they do not. No chef and no baker can ever know it all.
Yeah, the more you know, the less you know. I think that's what you have to learn at some point, right?
Yeah, there's a it's called, I think it's called the Dunning-Kruger effect. And so there's a philosopher, I don't know the exact, but basically the Dunning-Kruger effect is confidence and competence. And so it starts off and you're like, you're up here and you're on top of the mountain and everything's the best. And then all of a sudden you go totally in the shit and you're in what's called the Valley of Despair. And then you slowly climb up into sustainability, and then the peak of enlightenment. It's worth looking up for any bakers, because I think your first couple sourdoughs, I did it, I'm a genius, I made sourdough, and then you have this flat bake, and you're like, what? And you really, and that's when you get into what you're talking about, is that the more you know, the less you actually know, and then you start to look at, well, how was my and then it's like a whole rabbit hole that you can never escape from.
Oh yes, so true. Yeah. Okay, yeah, Matthew, thank you so much. It has been a pleasure. all the best to you, and maybe we can do this again sometime. Sure. It has been so much fun chatting with you.
Yeah, I'd love to. Maybe we can do it on my Instagram. I can host you one time. I'm gonna be hopefully working on some YouTube content. It's a very new world to me, but I'll hopefully put some up, and so maybe we can do this again once I've got a few more videos.
Sure, that would be amazing. Would love to do that. All right. Okay, then thank you so much, everybody. I'm going to be ending the broadcast now.
Awesome. Thank you, everyone, for coming. Thanks for all your great questions.